I'm Arthur Boyle of Performance Appraisal Services. We're residential real estate appraisers with a company founded in 1994 by Mike Gianelli and I in the basement of my house in Malden. We've since grown to have offices in Malden and Pembroke. We serve the eastern Mass counties, including Cape Cod. A good client for us is an attorney or a private landowner or a private property owner who's going through a probate process or a divorce division of property. Call us at 781-293-6900. Ask for Arthur Boyle or Amanda Boyle Grazioso. Our first name is Performance.
Welcome to the Board of Selectmen's meeting of January 23rd, 2017, and we'll begin our meeting with the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through a live video and audio broadcast on Comcast Government Access Channel 15 and is being recorded for broadcast at future dates. Comments made in open session will be recorded. And the first item this evening is from our treasurer, Kathleen McCarthy, and she's requesting that the board vote to extend the useful life of borrowing items. And I will ask our clerk, Arthur Boyle, to read the motion into the record.
Move that the maximum useful life of departmental equipment listed below be financed with the proceeds of the borrowing authorized by the votes of town meeting passed April 18, 2015. It was Article 18 and Action Number 19. And is hereby determined pursuant to General Law Chapter 44, Subchapter 7-9 to be as follows. Purpose, borrowing amount, and maximum useful life. It'll be a 10-wheel dump truck sander and attachments. Borrowing amount is $312,750 for 10 years. Snowblower and blades for the backhoe from DPW, $110,500 for 10 years. Front loader and attachments, $350,300 for 10 years. Trackless multi-purpose tractor and attachments, $176,450 for 10 years. And further, that the maximum useful life of departmental equipment listed below will be financed with the proceeds of the borrowing authorized by the votes of the town passed May 10th, 2016, Article 4, Action 2, is hereby determined pursuant to General Law Chapter 44, Subchapter 7-9. To be as follows: 64-gallon trash receptacles, $325,000, maximum useful life 6 years. And further, that the maximum useful life of the departmental equipment list below to be financed with the proceeds of the borrowing authorized by the votes of the town passed October 18, 2016, in Article 1, Action 13, is hereby determined pursuant to General Law Chapter 44, Subchapter 7-9, to be as follows: for the mini pumper fire engine, $220,000, 10 years.
Second.
Thank you, Arthur. Motion by Arthur, second by Bill. Do the selectmen have any questions for Kathleen? Hearing none, all those in favor of this vote, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, it's unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kathleen. Our next appointment this evening is for Mr. Andy Goodman. Mr. Goodman, is he here? He is not here. He wants to address the selectmen about his request for the use of the town roads, Learning Lane, Harbormark, Lake Valley, and Plain, for a third year in a row to hold the Pan Mass Challenge Bicycle Race. He was going to be here to give us an update on the charity work that the Pan Mass Challenge does. But our job is to vote on his request, with the approval of the police chief. I have a motion.
I would move the granting of the use of the town road subject to the approval of the police chief. Andy Goodman is an extraordinary guy and a great organizer and has done some terrific work in the past, and I'm sure he will continue to do it in the future.
Second.
Thank you, Arthur. A motion by Arthur, second by Bill. Does the board have any questions or issues with this request? Hearing none. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. That's unanimous. We're a little early for our appointment with the advisory board.
You want to get into board action items?
Yes, we could do that, certainly. We have the, the fire chief was here.
That's what I'll take it.
Okay, we have under action items, the first item is for the Board of Selectmen to consider awarding a contract for design services and site evaluation for police and fire stations.
Mr. Chairman, you have before you a, an agreement for professional engineering services with Castle Blues Associates Incorporated for design services and site evaluation for police and fire stations. And we are recommending that the board vote to approve this engineering contract to the tune of $44,000.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Bill.
I'm willing to make a motion on that, but I'd just like to say that I, amongst Dan and a lot of other people, met with this company and also read four of the books that had to do with people that do these site evaluations and all that. And this particular company here just kind of set, in my opinion, set out front that would do a really good job for Pembroke. And so unless there's any other questions, I would like to move that we enter into a contract with Castle Blues Associates for design services and site evaluation for the police and fire stations.
Second.
We have a motion by Bill and a second by Arthur. Does the board have any questions or comments? Dan?
Yes, I just want to echo what Bill said. I sat on the subcommittee as well, and this company is certainly up to the task, and they were without question the best that applied for this project. And if I can just ask Ed as town administrator to explain to the board and the public the cost of this contract versus what was allotted in town meeting.
Right now the allocation that was appropriated by town meeting was $50,000. There's a couple of add-ons that we'll probably try to negotiate with the firm, but right now the contract, the base contract is for $44,000. You know, hopefully we settle for that. There's a couple of things like some evaluations of response time and things like that that were discussed with Castle Blues, but that were, as they were in their proposal to the town, it was in excess of the 44, and that's something I'll probably have to talk to both chiefs and the subcommittee about.
Great.
I would like to get the contract underway and get these folks started on the overall project.
Very good. And again, Mr. Chairman, I can't recommend this firm any more than I already did.
Thank you, Dan. Anyone else comments? Hearing none, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, I rule it to be unanimous. Thank you. We have our advisory board present for a 7:10 appointment, and I would recognize Linda Peterson, the chairman of advisory. Thank you.
Good evening.
We had asked for this meeting because we had decided at the last meeting that it would be beneficial to both the Board of Selectmen and to the Advisory Board to get together and discuss mutual issues and what have you. And I'm hoping this will become a dialogue and not a monologue on our part. We've limited the agenda because shortly I'm going to turn this over to Tim Brennan, who's done a great deal of work for us on the OPEB, the monstrous issue that's headed to the town in the next number of years. There are just two other things I quickly would like to bring up, and one is the memorandum that we sent to the Board of Selectmen regarding the collective bargaining agreements and the fact that most of those are in executive session. We did get a couple of responses on some of the minutes. However, we were less than thrilled with the response to the written in the minutes. We referred it to town council, and town council agreed with what was already written. Our main objection is that particularly in one of the set of minutes, for 45 minutes, the only documentation is discussion ensued. Now, I don't believe that helps the town of Pembroke in any way to not know what was negotiated. I'm not a lawyer, so I don't know what is permissible to ask, but I think we should know what the town is offering and what the unions are asking in some way, so that when this comes up at town meeting, when the contracts are asked to be approved, the town people know what they're approving. It's not sufficient in my estimation just to say it's been negotiated and here it is, folks, take it or leave it. I think they should know a little bit about what has been negotiated. Now, would someone for the Board of Selectmen like to respond to why they feel that the way the minutes are worded? I realize it's legal, but is there anything that the board can do to at least help the townsfolk understand why what is being asked for and what is being given is really negotiated?
Well, I have not myself seen the minutes that you're referring to, so I have not read them so that I could understand.
They're very limited. They just will say the people that are there, when it started, when it ended, and a little bit about this particular one was 45 minutes, and all it really said was, we can certainly see, Sabrina sent them to us, so it should be available to you folks. And they're minutes that you probably in the past had approved anyway, but I can understand why you wouldn't remember exactly.
Well, we don't usually approve the minutes until the issue was closed.
Okay, these
finalized.
Were closed. These were closed.
Okay, and I wasn't, like I said, not knowing what specific minutes that you're referring to, I'm a little lost.
Okay,
here.
I think in general, what is discussed when any of the negotiations are brought forth by any of the town unions, as to a little bit of what they're asking and what the town is offering.
Well, I think if I, you know,
go ahead, Bill.
Mr. Sure. Chairman, if I could say something that's in negotiation sessions, you have to understand that that the unions that come in and negotiate are looking for top of the line, you know, 100% whatever they want, however many articles. The town, in fact, has pretty much of a summary like what we can afford to give them. So it's a give and take proposition, and there's a lot of negotiation back and forth about they may want their birthday off, or they may want an extra you know, day here or there, or they might want to change the schedule of it. They could be asking for, you know, as many as 10 or 12 or 15 different items and hoping that they're going to get every one of them, and unfortunately they don't. And I've been on both sides of the negotiation table, so I understand where the unions are coming from, and we're always asking for as much as we can possibly get as the union, and the town is saying no, we can't afford that amount of things.
So though, that once a contract is signed, what was asked for is available for information. Am I incorrect in that?
I'm not really sure about that, to be honest with you, but the whole thing is that they could be asking for 20 different items.
I understand.
And it ends up that they only get two or three of them. So in the negotiation process, it's...
I understand that, because everything that is, most things that are given, there's a dollar a cent amount.
Right.
And as I say, I don't want to belabor this at this point in time, but I would request that the board look into it and see if some of their minutes and can be helpful, at least to the townsfolk, so they know when the contract comes up that what they're voting for may be the best that the town could offer, or I'm not...
Okay. Linda, frankly, there are items that you discuss and speak about during negotiation that should not be put out to the public as fact, because when the unions come in, they, as Bill alluded to, they shoot for the moon.
Absolutely.
And it would if you're not in a negotiating session and you just Joe public, you would frankly find it insulting, some of the things that the starting points. So, and those are starting points. So we understand that as a negotiating team. So I don't think it'd be helpful or prudent to put out for public consumption starting points.
Okay.
Because that's what they are. So hopefully you're not asking that. Hopefully you're asking what we were down when we were down to brass tacks and we were going back and forth. That's something we could possibly consider releasing to you folks in
that,
the public.
That should be highlighted in the contracts when it's now signed.
Yeah.
As provided they come out and far enough and are available on the web and everything, so that townsfolk can see that. But as I say, that's just something that.
And the other thing, if I can finish, when this board comes to a conclusion in an agreement, we have gotten to brass tacks. It's hard to say, trust us, we work hard. But that's what we're asking you to do, because we do work hard, and we do, when we come to a final contract, we are at the rock bottom that we can get without having to go to Beacon Hill and the unions and the town
no,
sue each other.
I realized to go to arbitration, and
yeah.
You know, that's backfired on us a number of times. So
right.
I understand that. As I say, we're just asking for a little more transparency. That's all.
I understand, and I think this is a dialogue that, and I know it's a bullet point for you tonight, but it's something that we could talk about a little more if you like, because I don't want it to be bullet pointed tonight and then swept under the rug by us later and never get back to you.
Not when it involves the dollars and cents. It will not be swept under the rug, I guarantee that.
Can I recognize Steve?
Mr. Chairman, through you, it's we're not trying to say that any individual is not doing his job. We're trying to push something new in the process, because the board's going to change. Over the years, it's going to be different people in here. And like it or not, some of them we're not going to trust, you know, and some we're going to. But it's going to change over the years. And if we can get a little more openness in the process so that people are a little, because all we see is the finished product. This is what we negotiated it down to. We have no idea if they ask for three things and you gave them two, or if they ask for 20 and you gave them two. We don't know. And we're just looking for a little more, because it's the taxpayers' money. It's not ours. It's not yours. It's taxpayers' money, and we think that the more public it is, the better. And I guess that's really the point we're trying to make. The more openness about the process, the more we know.
I recognize Jim McCall.
Bottom line is a 45-minute discussion in contract negotiations, discussion ensued, is not appropriate. That is not appropriate under any circumstances. Discussion ensued. About what? The open meeting law requires you to include the topics that were discussed, and town council says you don't have to have a transcript, but you have to have information to let people know what happened. and discussion ensued doesn't tell you anything.
Okay.
It stinks.
Well, I think one of the hardest parts is that usually the ground rules are set on the first meeting that you meet. And part of the ground rules usually are after the third or the fourth meeting, that's it. You can't put anything else in there. So they may come in with, any one of the unions may come in with 6, 7, 8 items that is strong for them that they want. We go back and discuss amongst ourselves. So a discussion ensued might mean that we left the room and we went and discussed it amongst ourselves, and the union went and discussed that amongst themselves. And then when we come back together again...
This is Board of Selectmen executive sessions that have been released. It has nothing to do with negotiating. You don't keep minutes for the negotiation. That's not a public document.
So you're asking for the executive session meeting?
The executive session, once the situation is resolved, an executive session minutes have to be made public. And we
so I was under the assumption you were asking for what's going on at the...
Just executive session minutes
On
issues that have been settled.
And
we're referring to, there was a 45-minute meeting that listed who was there, and it said discussion ensued.
Okay.
Well, I think that's a fair comment, and I can't disagree with much of what you said at all. And I will look into that, and the board will.
And I believe town council had said that was appropriate. The
right.
Town council looked at that and said it was appropriate. So.
The only alternative that we have, if we feel it's still unfair, would be to go to the Secretary of State, and I don't think we want to hear our dirty laundry in the public. All right, that one other thing, just one thing I want to mention before I turn it over to Tim, and that is this River Marsh Village housing development is being proposed. We are now under the 10% that allows the town to know what's good for the town of Pembroke. It's in the hands of, I believe, the developers and everybody else, but we do not have control of it. We need to get above that 10%, and I would suggest whoever is involved in this to push the developer to give us make as many affordable housing units in that decision to get us over that 10%. Because every house that's individual house in Pembroke that's built cuts into that 10%, and we need to get rise above it so that we have a say of the developments that work into the town of Pembroke. And that's all, whatever.
Yeah, just make a comment on that. That could be a negotiable issue with the developer.
Yes.
But by law, it's 25%.
Okay.
Of all of the units must be affordable. Maybe we could negotiate 30%.
26 or 30.
Or 40%.
If we start and try to get something more, and I'm not picking on whatever this developer particularly is.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just saying that the 40B projects, to my understanding, do not allow the town to have much control over the projects. And I think that's wrong in the basis of law. But that's the way it is. So what we can do to try to protect the town of Pembroke and try to make it a better community with whatever we deal with as we believe that the town of Pembroke should entail.
Well, a week from tonight, there will be a hearing.
Right.
And the developer of the project will be here. And we're looking for a large turnout of interested residents in Pembroke.
And I think you
and they can have their questions answered by the developer or further looked into.
Who is responsible for Water Street if and when this ever gets built? Does the town have to, 68 units, maybe 100 cars and those units coming in and out twice a day is not going to be very happy for the size of that Water Street road.
That's right.
Whose expense is that? The town's?
The town's.
That's another point.
Chapter 40B can be oppressive on towns.
That's why I'm saying we need to at least try to extract what we can.
Sure.
While we're allowed.
Well, so I think we probably would have been ahead of our numbers if Pembroke Woods had started their development when they did. And
But I've also understood that we lose track of some of the houses that are 40Bs, so we're our own worst enemy in some cases.
That had been the case in the past. It had been.
Right. Do we know if it's still ongoing?
It is not ongoing. For the last three, probably 4 years, we've had a really good handle on it. We've had the administrator's office have a dedicated person on that, looking into that. Vicki, she's done a great job, and she's turned that around. But that was the case in the past.
Jim McCollum?
How many 40Bs have we lost over the past 15 years?
15 years?
Yes.
That I couldn't answer, but I know recently.
When I was on the Affordable Housing Committee, I did a spreadsheet on all of this, and we were preciously close to being at 10%.
We were over it.
We were over
10%. We were at 10.65 at one point, I remember.
We've lost those. We've basically thrown them away, and now we're having to make them up. The only entity that benefits from 40B is the developer, not the town, and not the residents who live there.
Ed?
The reason we went under 10% after Pembroke Woods was built was because the 2010 census showed that the base number of housing units in a town grew, and therefore all the numbers that we were over 10%, even if we lost 5 or 6 units, we were still 22 short after the 2010 census. Now, with the Birchtree 40B project, we will be at 9.79%. This project at Water Street Extension, if the 17 units are being proposed, will put the town by 3 units over 10% if it's approved by the Zoning Board of Appeals and by Mass Housing. So, you know, we're a little, but the reason we went under 10% is because the town grew, and Mass Housing uses the census of year-round single-family units as being the base number, and our number increased from 2000 to 2010.
That will always happen every time there's a census, because there are going to be more single-family houses than there are 40B developments, so it behooves us to get a jump on this if we're able to, and I think if the developer is reasonable, they may allow us 1 or 2 more affordable units.
The other issue that you have is if someone owns an affordable home and they want to sell, they have to sell it for the affordable price under the rules
right. That
they bought the house under. And we've had 3 houses that I'm aware of that they couldn't find a person to meet the requirements of an affordable home. So they sold it for market price.
And
we lost those 3 houses, and the town got some money out of it. But we'd rather have the houses than the money.
I agree. I mean, I think these are all things that need to be brought up. I don't have any answers personally, but I think it's just something that we need to keep on the forefront.
I know we're holding you longer than you want.
Well,
but
I want to have Tim to talk, because that's the main.
Can we hold him one more second? Your point about the houses they don't sell. There is a spread in that goes from the affordable price that they were unable to sell it or find a buyer for to the market rate, and we get a portion of the difference. So
it boggles the mind that you can't sell it at an affordable rate. What's wrong with these homes that they won't sell it in the settlement market rate?
Deed restrictions.
It's the deed restriction, and that's true. It has to be resold again.
And you've got to find a qualified candidate who meets the income guidelines, and that's sometimes difficult to do. But there's a formula that takes into account open space and how much land you have in conservation and what you've got for lakes and ponds and that kind of thing. That I understand Kathy Salmon is working on, because it's a complicated matrix that gets you, if you're not over the 10%, you can use this as your way out of 40B. So I'm not sure that it's a foregone conclusion that they'll be able to build up on West Water Street. I think that we need to, you know, dig our heels in a little bit with the state.
That's all I'm asking, is that we be as proactive as we can be to guarantee that we're talking in the best interest of the entire town. That's all.
Okay.
Tim is going to talk the more depressing part of it, which is the OPEB.
Exciting stuff. I think the advisory committee as a whole has kind of come to the conclusion over the past several months. I think generally the perception of the committee is we're kind of petty pitchers, micromanaging budgets and things like that. Nobody likes coming in to talk to us, really. I think historically there's been a need for the committee to do things like that. But I think moving forward, the more we've looked at things, our role becomes more valuable if we move outside that role and start focusing on some of the bigger budgetary and financial issues that are facing the town. So I want to talk a little bit about that tonight and just go over some stuff. Hopefully it's things that you guys have heard of before, but I think what we'd like is to kind of, as we shift our focus onto some of these big picture financial issues, we hope to work with you guys more and kind of take what we find and educate you guys so we can work together and make sure that this doesn't become a bigger problem than it already is. So I think we're starting to see, and I'm sure Mike and Ed has talked to you guys about this, we're starting to see kind of a crunch when it comes to how much health care costs, pension costs, and OPEB liabilities are starting to weigh on the budget every year. And if we look at kind of some numbers, I put a couple charts on this first page. These numbers might help me put these together. And I think first, if you want to look at this table at the bottom of the page, this is kind of what really drives it, what some of the problems are becoming. When we kind of look at the increases in health insurance costs and pension liabilities over the past several years, versus what's allowable from the tax levy increase, you can kind of see in these last few years, all, if not more than all, of what's allowable by the tax levy increase is being eaten up by our pension liabilities and our healthcare spend. So that's gonna cause a problem, and it's gonna cause, you know, there are conflicting, residents of the town want certain services, they have certain priorities, and this is starting to kind of really hinder that. And when we look at kind of long-term projections of what things like pension and OPEB and health insurance are going to end up costing the town as a percentage of the budget, I think you can see that about 10 years ago, that number was coming in around below 10% of the overall budget. And projections from Mike now and from the PCA, Plymouth County Retirement, and I guess some of the health insurance consultants, you know, by 2025, that number is over 25%, and then when we look out to 2030, we're looking at over a third of our budget is consumed by these costs. And you can imagine that we're not exactly increasing the tax base. Legally, we can't even increase the tax base, or we don't have the type of growth that can really keep up with that the growth in these costs. So it's something that we as a town, you guys as a board, us as a finance committee, and Ed, and the employees of the town really have to start thinking about this and how we can best plan for it. And I think what really kind of puts it into perspective is if we look at Pembroke's pension plus their health care increases, the past 5 years, that number has gone up about $1 million, 12%. And what it's expected, those two costs are expected to go up in the next 5 years, is $3.2 million. So we have to start thinking, well, where is that extra money going to come from? And right now, there's really no clear answer. So it's just something we really want to start thinking about. Kind of the next page, I want to kind of rattle off some facts that I think would be helpful to kind of get a visualization of how big this problem really is. So since 2009, where we're thinking of, I think the majority of the pension is really funded by how much money we have in it and how those investments grow. So if you think 2009, where we're at the bottom of a market and you see how much the market has gone up since then, you would assume that Pembroke's unfunded liability would actually decrease a lot in that time. Truth be told, the liability's actually probably gone up about 40% since then. So in 2009, our unfunded pension liability was about $19.5 million. As of the end of 2015, that number sat at $27.5 million. So these issues aren't really something that we can simply fund our way out of. I think it's going to take some kind of structural changes in how the system is, because it's not really fair for us to ask taxpayers to throw money at a problem before we really have identified what the problem is and how we can think about fixing it. So Plymouth County Retirement Association, they value the pension liability based on a pretty lofty return expectation in the last like 10 years, between 8 and 8.5%. There's a lot of debate on this. I'm sure you hear it on the news. People always say pension expectations are way too high. That's fair. I think what's more important to put into perspective is Plymouth County, in particular, hasn't met those return expectations over the past 15 years. Or if you look at 5, 10, 15-year periods, even 19-year periods, they haven't come close to their own expectations. The reason that happens is the way they value their pension is based on almost a 31-year number, which is when you think about what the economic environment was like between 1985 and 2000, you had the S&P 500, the stock market, going up 19% a year. You had 10-year bonds returning 7.5% a year. Those are the glory days. And when they're trying to set their expectations going forward, using that time period in their calculations kind of skews everything. And if you kind of look at what those numbers are now, you know, the 10-year bond has about return about 2%, 2.5%. So the future returns should be muted quite a bit from what we've gotten in the past. And I think that kind of really plays into how we as a town should be thinking about our pension liability. If that return assumption was lower just 1% to 7%, which some would probably call lofty, Pembroke's unfunded liability as of the end of 2015 jumps up to $34 million. It's approximately, not exactly, but every 1% increase every 1% decrease in that discount rate is about a 25% increase in our unfunded liability. So it's kind of an alarming way to look at it. When you think about maybe a more reasonable expectation is 6%, Pembroke's liability is right around $40 million for our pension. So in the last 10 years, Pembroke's paid towards its liability $21.5 million. In the coming 10 years, according to Plymouth County, Pembroke will owe $35.4 million. So again, we're looking at almost a 50% increase in our costs for the next 10 years going out. And what I think is really important to consider here is that the Plymouth County Retirement Association is not accountable to Pembroke taxpayers. So when they're setting these return expectations and they're kind of telling us what our pension liabilities are, I think it's our responsibility, and I think this is really the recommendation that comes down from the state and accounting standards, that we should be able to have a defensible position on what our pension liabilities are. We can't just rely on what Plymouth County Retirement Association is giving us. And I think if we were to do that, we could be a little bit more responsible in how we think about our unfunded liability. It would probably be a lot higher, but at least we wouldn't be kind of relying on somebody else to tell us what it is, especially given their past performance and what's happened. So I think it's the duty of the town to calculate that on its own, whether it's bringing in our own independent actuaries. It's something we should be doing, and the state actually recommends that we do that. As far as OPEB goes, this is kind of the quiet giant that not a lot of people talk about this, and it's really a bigger issue than the pensions. OPEB is kind of where pensions were probably 30 years ago before towns started actually funding them. And if you think about OPEB, it's even more challenging than pensions, where you're looking at pensions, you basically have a defined benefit with pretty much a defined cost. But with OPEB, you have a defined or a guaranteed benefit with a totally undefined cost. And especially as we've seen in recent years, is our healthcare costs are kind of skyrocketing. And that creates a problem. Pembroke has guaranteed payments they have to make towards health insurance to a lot of people. And our unfunded liability in that realm is massive. And next year, that liability has to show up on the town's balance sheet for the first time, and I think it's going to open a lot of eyes. The key drivers to that are premium contributions for active employees and retirees, plan design and eligibility. Some of this stuff is done, a lot of this stuff is done through collective bargaining, and a lot of this stuff doesn't have to be done through collective bargaining. So these are just kind of some of the things we should be thinking about. I'm not here to kind of tonight to talk about what some of those solutions could be, just more to kind of bring light to what some of the issues are. As of today, I talked to Mike, so I think Pembroke has put aside for OPEB about $600,000. As of July 1st, 2014, Pembroke had a $36 million unfunded liability. So we haven't really saved anything. And if you think about as of 2014, when you look at what kind of the actuaries came in and gave us for a projection for a evaluation, they were saying that, you know, 10 years out, I think by 2026, based on their estimates, Pembroke's unfunded liability would be about $40 million. When you kind of dig into the report, that's 2 years ago, we all know what would have happened with healthcare costs since then. They were basing their assumption on healthcare costs increasing 5% per year, which, you know, in the last couple of years, we've seen a 30% increase, so that number is pretty laughable. And I think when, again, I spoke to Mike about this today, when we see a new valuation for our OPEB liabilities, it should come out the second half of this year, the number is going to be staggering. So I think it's important to really consider that when we consider our unfunded pension liability, plus what's going to be a really massive unfunded OPEB liability, Pembroke will effectively have a negative net worth. Again, it's kind of this doom and gloom thing, but it's something we really have to think about. And, you know, it's not, all's not lost now. We just have to start thinking about it and how are we going to solve these issues? So I think, you know, right now, one of the bigger things is, you know, Pembroke taxpayers pay between 75 and 85% of the premiums for retiree plans. That's well above the state required minimum 50%. And if you look across the state, a lot of towns are starting to make these tough decisions where they're saying, look, retirees have to pay 50%. And that really knocks down your unfunded liability, and it's kind of in line, you know, it's an unfortunate trade-off, but it's a fair trade-off given the situation that the town is in. So that's just kind of one thing to think about, and that's something that can be done outside of collective bargaining. There's no easy solution to this. I think what we wanted to do coming here and kind of going forward is to focus on kind of education and awareness to residents, to you guys, to taxpayers, employees, and retirees, because it's important, because these decisions that we're going to have to make in future years to kind of stem off and fight off this problem, they're not going to be easy decisions that have to be made. I think we have to kind of explore meaningful changes in the health plan, which I'm sure you guys are constantly talking about and are aware of. And premium contributions to active employees and to retirees. I think the onus is on us as a town and you as a board to push retirement boards to think about changing some of their eligibility and how they're acting and managing the funds. You know, that's the retirement boards, the teachers board, and Plymouth County Retirement, they're totally unaccountable to the taxpayers of Pembroke. So when we think about bargaining chips we're bringing to the table during contract negotiations, that's something you can use. It's, you know, why is Plymouth County Retirement Board giving cost of living increases 3% every single year when Social Security is giving zero? That costs the town more money, and you can kind of use that. If you're aware of it, you can use it and say, well, we have less money to kind of give you in these contracts because of that. And just thinking of things like that. There are a lot of things like that. And I think a big thing, too, is to put pressure on the boards. And even, you know, when we do our own liabilities, like I was saying before, I think we should really focus on evaluating our own liabilities outside of what Plymouth County is doing, and particularly with OPEB, to use reasonable discount rates that are kind of based on reality and not based on kind of what happened 30 years ago. I think if we do that, then it's a lot easier for us to focus on the actual problem now than pushing it down the road and saying, well, you know, we'll tackle that when we get there, because it's, I think you can see on the chart on the first page, I think that's the kind of the mindset for a long time. We'll tackle that when we get there. And now we're here. So we're here where our tax levy increase is consumed by these, and it looks like things are only really going to get worse. So I mean, our hope going forward is that we kind of shift our focus into dealing with some of these issues, and hopefully we can work more closely with you guys to educate and come up and kind of share with what we found and some possible solutions into kind of solving the issue. And I think kind of piggybacking on what Linda said, when we go into the, you know, collective bargaining, the challenge is always for us is, you know, we're in front of the town and town meeting looking to make a recommendation for the town whether or not we agree with what was offered, but we don't know what's offered. And we've asked in the past to be included in that process, and it seems in the past that everybody on the board was agreeable to bringing in advisory, but we've yet to have an invitation. So I'd hope that the board would consider involving us more going forward, because I think as we dive into this stuff, we will have a lot of useful information that we can share with you guys.
I think you'll find a lot of the unions have their union negotiation through state law is that they have a right to bargain with the Board of Selectmen, not with any other. And years ago, we used to bargain with different boards, and they would come before the Board of Selectmen, and the Board of Selectmen said no. And then that's what ruled that to say that that the unions will negotiate with the Board of Selectmen, period, because they don't want to go through all these steps to get to the final people to do that. I mean, I can remember going to 19 negotiation sessions, and you get to the very end, they bring it in the selectmen, they go, nope, we don't want that, and they throw it back. So it's forced the unions into saying, we want to bargain strictly with the Board of Selectmen. But
you are the ultimate authority, but I don't believe it means that you could not have other people part of the, maybe with voice and no vote or something, if it's, I mean, you have Koppelman and Page in there. They're not a selectman.
I'd say you could use us as a tool.
We do have a right to have counsel.
Right.
So,
but there has to
and be. So don't they. Matter of fact, the last negotiations we had counsel. We decided to go to counsel. We had counsel with our negotiation sessions, and so didn't the union.
We should
they
always
had counsel.
Have counsel. Because there may be loopholes, things that we're not aware of. They get into a contract, and believe me, they never come out.
But I mean, speaking as a town employee for years, it's the health care cost is not a town issue problem. It's a nationwide problem.
Sure.
that is driven up by greed, in my opinion, because some of these pharmacies and all that, pills that used to cost 3 cents or 4 cents to make, they're charging you $35 or $40 for a pill. It's like, it's crazy.
Yeah.
The extra should not fall totally on the town of Pembroke. Believe me.
No, but unfortunately it does.
It should be shared equally between the employees and the town.
I guess one of the things that we're really seeing is almost every town around here is at 50%.
That's not true, because I've got the figures right here. There are some of them.
Yeah.
There are a few that are on the 50%, probably out of 20 towns. I think we have three here that have gone to 50%.
One thing I'd say is that I know that's used a lot, I'm sure, in negotiations comparing to towns, but I think that lacks a lot of context. Like, every town has its different challenges. Every town has different means of generating revenue. Every town has different needs of expenses coming down the pipe. So it's tough to kind of look at a number of what surrounding towns are paying and really draw too many conclusions on that. But I don't think our purpose tonight was to come up with solutions. It's more to kind of present problems and kind of let you guys know these are things we're thinking of and hopefully going forward.
Believe me, we've thought of them.
Yeah, well, it's now it's becoming a real problem.
But to solve it is something else, though.
Okay, but we're representing the townsfolk, and so you should be. That should be primarily why you're here. And I realize that when you negotiate with unions, they want everything. But the townsfolk do matter, and that's why you were elected, to make these hard decisions.
Well, believe me, they're hard decisions to make.
I'm not minimizing, and we
definitely have. And I've been to Boston a good many, many times with the unions, and, you know, it's not a pleasant a pleasant thing to do, but unfortunately, it depends who sits in on those negotiation sessions in Boston that says that you will accept this. It's not something that we wanted on a lot of these things. It's something the state turns around and says, this is what everybody else is getting, that's what you're going to give them. And we're stuck with it, and we have to do that. So
we just have to do the best we can. Yeah. That's all I think anybody is asking of anybody.
And I think all the negotiation sessions that we've had, we've really tried hard to hold down. Nobody's, believe me, you talk to the union reps in each one of these unions and tell them if it's an easy negotiation session to sit in on negotiations with the board, and they'll tell you there's no way, you know. They don't get anything for nothing. And we're trying our very best to do the best for the town. So.
Dan?
I wanted to jump in, yeah, unless we're done. So Tim, the advisory, just thanks so much for bringing this up to us. It's something that you know, we are aware of, but we don't have, certainly not the expertise that you have, and to highlight all these items is certainly eye-opening to us to know the facts for Pembroke. But I do want to know, you've done a great study on Pembroke. How do we sit with other towns as far as OPEB and pension liabilities? Because from what I gather, and I try to read what I can, I'm not an accountant, but I do try to read it as a layman, and I seem to find that a rule of thumb seems to be people's OPEB obligations are about what their annual town budget is. Is that
probably higher?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we're types lower if
well,
it's about $40 million.
I would expect that when at the end of this year it will be pretty massive. I don't know, but based on if it was $36 million and they were projecting 5% increases, and we're probably looking at a 30% increase, I'd imagine the unfunded liability is probably 60. Maybe higher.
Okay, so a rule of thumb about the annual town,
yeah,
budget. So we know where we are, or we think we know where we're going to be. In the hole, certainly, and it's time for action for our part, and obviously your part too. We need your assistance. But have any other towns been proactive, and what steps have they taken that? Because plagiarism in municipal government,
yeah,
is not only legal, but it's helpful.
Encouraged. Yeah, so I mean, a lot of towns have done a lot of I think half the towns in Massachusetts, probably a little less, or they've boosted retiree share to 50%, and that cuts down the liability a lot. Some of them are looking at service continuation requirements, which I think can be done outside of collective bargaining, meaning if you're going to retire, if you want ongoing benefits when you retire from the town, you have to be working for the town when you retire. I'm not sure if that's something Pembroke has in place. You know, I think they do things where surviving spouses that still, and again, I'm not sure what Pembroke is. I know this is just common that surviving spouses get continuing health care coverage. A lot of towns are basically grandfathering in current surviving spouses and eliminating that benefit going forward. You know, people are also coming up with a plan to fund it. I think in surrounding towns, I think Hingham is one town that's was kind of way ahead on the OPEB thing, and I think they have a pretty good sized chunk of money put away. But I mean, you're right. I mean, I think most towns, like I said, you know, this isn't an issue that's unique to Pembroke by any means. But that's not any reason to not address it. So it's, I think, you know, there's certainly, and this kind of the stuff we're going to be looking into, like what have other towns done? Andover's been going through this process the last year and a half, and I think we're trying to get somebody that's on the Andover Retirement Board to come down and talk to us about how they've actually started to address this stuff. Because, like you said, I think it's going to be beneficial as we move forward to talk to other towns that have gone through this rather than reinventing the wheel. But from talking with those guys and others, it's, you know, it's not easy. You get a lot of pushback, but at some point, I think it's really about kind of educating the taxpayers and the people working for the town, the retirees, and you just have to kind of show them, you know, what reality looks like. And it, if it, you know, the current path is unsustainable. You can kind of keep going in and renegotiating things and chipping slowly away, but you kind of look at, you know, we've been chipping away for a few years, and, you know, the unfunded liability keeps growing. So it's not something we can simply just say, okay, we're going to put $2 million a year in an OPEB and it will go away. There are just structural changes you have to make. It's not, same thing with the pension, it's not something we can really just fund our money out of. And to be honest, I think it would probably be irresponsible to just throw money at kind of a system that I think is clearly in need of reforms. So.
Can we take an adjournment on this? It's more to come and it's not going to go away, so we look forward to maybe another round on this particular topic when what you've looked into and what you've come up with and maybe what we've come up with and see where we can put a plan in place. I won't say, you know, a solution, but a plan.
Yeah, I think that's a fair assessment, and I think the board would agree with that. You have a lot to think about, and I want to thank you for all the work you've done and what you've put in front of us. We have a lot to think about.
Yeah, thanks for the time. I mean, I hope we continue. Like, you know, I don't think we need enough. I don't think finance guys need enough. So I hope we can kind of get something on the calendar to kind of come back in a couple months and hopefully have something else to discuss and kind of push forward. So.
All right. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Now we have Mr. Shea is here. Dave, would you like to come up?
I was going to say, would you like to take the library trustee on her quick request before
Mr.
Shea comes up?
Oh, certainly.
Meredith, please go with the microphone. This is Meredith Cartwright. I apologize for that.
Okay, thank you very much. You can tell us who you are. I'm not sure.
Sure, Meredith Cartwright, chair of the library trustees.
Thank you for coming.
I'm here because one of our longtime trustees, Elaine Spalding, recently stepped down and resigned from the trustees, so we had a vacated position. Carol Watches has put in a letter of intent to, in a request to be appointed to the position until she can run for election to complete the term.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for coming tonight. We don't see much of the library trustees. Welcome.
We're always over there.
Yes, you
Thank
are.
You. Thank you.
Yes. Well, I'm looking at some documents we have, and it is, as you say, a longtime dedicated trustee. Elaine Spalding has submitted her resignation. So we have a motion number one to address Elaine Spalding. Do I have a motion?
Move to accept the resignation of Elaine Spalding with regret for her elected position as library trustee.
Second.
Motion by Bill, second by Arthur. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Number two motion would be moved to appoint Carol Watch of 19 Maple Ave to the interim vacancy of library trustee from January 23rd. 2017 to the next scheduled town election on May 13th, 2017.
Motion by Bill. Is there a second?
Second. Discussion. Is there a published act of succession for somebody who resigns and leaves an open seat?
No, it's an interim appointment of the Board of Selectmen until the next duly called election.
Okay.
So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
I have a question on this before we vote.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No problem. Could you please explain to us what qualifications Carol has for this position?
Sure. Carol has actually been involved with the Friends of the Library organization for over 15 years. She's been president of the organization for over 9 years. She's been involved in the fundraising efforts, been an advocate for the library. She did run for the trustees position. It was a three-way race at the time, unusual. So she is running again. She has also, been appointed to the Cultural Council, and previously she was a secretary and board member of the Pembroke Education Foundation.
Thank you.
Very impressive. Okay.
All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. It's unanimous.
Thank you very much.
And thank you very much for coming in.
Thank you.
Now, Mr. Shea.
Finally.
Well, it's often been said I know how to clear out a room, and now we have living proof.
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank you for changing your time and apologize for being so late and having you finally come to the podium.
Well, that's quite all right.
So thank you, Dave.
My pleasure, Mr. Chairman.
So you're going to give us an update, are you, on a possible series of things with the Chamber of Commerce?
Yeah, and first I'd like to thank the board, and I know I speak for everybody in the chamber, especially our board, but for asking us to come in and hopefully on a regular basis going forward. I've lived in Pembroke since 1986 after growing up in Duxbury. And when in growing up, you knew who owned the local general store, who owned the liquor store, who owned the gas station. It was a real community, and business supported the community, and the community supported business. But when it was brought to my attention that I should be a member of the Pembroke Chamber of Commerce back in 2008, my first reaction was, we have a Chamber of Commerce? And that's just not right. I became president 2 years later, and we've been on a mission to heighten the awareness of the chamber and all of our members to the community. And to that end, we try to encourage our members to get involved in the community. We try to create chamber-oriented events that will put our members face-to-face with the community that they want to support. And in return, we're hoping we can generate enough recognition for each and every member that the community in turn will want to support the chamber and its members. In this day and age of trying to balance five balls at once and trying to do whatever's easiest so you can get on to the next thing, all too often people do their business through the drive-through or to some big box or whatever the case might be. And we're very heartened that the Board of Selectmen has asked us to try to make an appearance on a regular basis so we could try to ratchet up the awareness of what our members do and what the Chamber is all about.
Excellent. Very good. Anybody have any questions for Dave? Arthur?
Yeah, as the one who brought this up originally, I appreciate Dave coming out and Mike and Barbara and as members of the Chamber. But I think, and Mike and I discussed this the other day at a mutual event, that people don't know necessarily that there's a CPA, an accountant in Pembroke, right in your neighborhood, who can do the tax things and the probate and the estates and all the things that have to be done when somebody passes. And rather than send them to Boston or to Weymouth or to Braintree, we can do it right here. We've got life insurance people like you. We've got Tiny and Sons Glass. There's so many businesses that people don't necessarily think about, because you're bombarded with television ads for Lowe's. We've got Samson Lumber as well as Lowe's, and there's every reason to go to Samson as there is to Lowe's, for most products. You've got the Ace Hardware that's done a great job with outreach to the community. You've got them as a source to keep you from having to drive all the way across almost a marsh field. So I thought it was appropriate that we give 4 or 5 minutes to the chamber on a regular basis to introduce their members or have their members introduce themselves and say what they do and what products they serve and what services they offer. And it makes sense to do business where we live.
I appreciate you saying that, Arthur. You mentioned Barbara and Mike. We're all in financial services to some degree or another. And I've done some research, and with the advent of the internet over the last two decades, 10 years ago, 38% of the public would try to do its research online. Now that's almost doubled 10 years later. And polls show that people want to work face-to-face with people, but when it comes to their money, they want to be in a group, and they don't want to pay for it, which I totally understand. I think what all of us offer is the ability to work with somebody that you know, somebody that you could put a face to the name, that you see around town, who is going to meet with you and have your best interest at heart. And it's always somebody that is giving back to the town, not just in a tax point of view, but contributing as a volunteer to the community. Barbara has done such a fantastic job as chairman of the Education Committee. When I joined the chamber, they had done away with the scholarships for worthy seniors at the high school. Barbara's built it up to where now we'll be handing out two $1,000 scholarships to two seniors at the end of May, beginning of June. We try to help the students that are in the DECA program, which, for those who aren't familiar with DECA, those are students that have an interest in going into business, go to college to learn about it, and then hopefully get into business themselves. And we have so many mentors that are members of the chamber, just having built a business on their own, that it's invaluable information that we provide for the students. So we're thrilled to be able to have one of our members come in every so often, speak before you, let you, and by speaking to you, let the townspeople know just what kind of people are right here in town that they can take advantage of. And at the same time, know that they'd be working with somebody that's giving back to, it could very well be them, as being a real part of the fabric of this community.
I think we kind of do that a little bit now, because when somebody comes in for a change of foreman or management or whatever, they come in, they introduce themselves to the board, explain what they do, how many pizzas they make, how many, you know, whatever else that they have that they're changing their business for. And that kind of introduces them to the public that are watching the TV, which is a good thing. And I kind of like the idea myself too, that Arthur brought you in, that we talk about things like this, because there is a lot of businesses in Pembroke, and there's a lot of people that maybe if they did come in and stand at the podium for 2 or 3 minutes and say, you know, I do tree cutting or whatever, and think of me when the next time a branch lands on your wires or something, and I'll come, you know, whatever. So it's I think it's a really good thing to do, and I applaud you as far as being the president of the chamber for a long time. I mean, you've been there for quite a while, and
Bill, they said whoever wants to be president, next step forward, and everybody took a step back, and there I was.
Yeah, there you go.
That's the way it works.
So, well, there has to be somebody there, you know.
And it's, I agree.
And it's good to see you up there, because it's...
Well, thank you, Bill. You know, we feel, while having a strong police department, a strong fire department, a strong school system, a strong town government can only build up the value of the town and the strength of the town, we also feel strongly that the business community can add to lifting the town up as a community and strengthening it. And we just want to be able to have our members recognized locally as, I don't need to drive to Hanover or Marshfield or Norwell to get this. I've got somebody right in town, and that's our whole focus.
I know on the police department, they started back up doing the Citizens Police Academy, and there's a lot of people that are interested in that, you know, want to go in and really see what the police do. And a lot of think, well, they drive around and drink coffee and eat donuts, you know, but there's so much that they do that people don't understand.
Sure.
And that could be a good thing, maybe starting some type of a group that did, not a police academy, but a citizen thing of Pembroke that and explain what these businesses do and how they do it.
Sure.
And now with all the video that's available and the drones that are running around and all the rest of the stuff, it's quite a thing. I think that you could, and that's where everybody is. Everybody's on the internet today, so.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I'd be remiss if I didn't remind the board and the townspeople that our annual legislative breakfast, which is held every March, will be Friday, March 24th. And from what I understand, we'll have every state representative within the bordering towns present for that, along with Vinnie DiMacedo. And I understand Bill Keating will also be joining us. So this will be a tremendous opportunity. We try to We try to shine the light on issues that are affecting not just businesses, but everybody in the town of Pembroke. And
I try not to miss prefaces, so I put that down there.
We'll take care of you on that. Also, Pembroke Day, we had our first annual Pembroke Day last August down at the Mattakeesett Fields. Yeah. That is scheduled for the 19th of August, which is a Saturday. Drew a lot of people. We raised almost $4,000 for charity, and we were able to put 15-20 of our business owners that are members of the chamber in front of the public that day. And I think we're starting something that's really going to catch on, so we're looking forward to this August.
That's great.
Thank you for the time. Really appreciate it.
Well, thank you for coming in, and we will come up with a regular schedule.
Great.
And we'll continue to have the chamber come before us.
Awesome.
Thank you Mr. very
Chairman.
Much.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you.
We've received a request from the Recreation Commission Chairman to appoint a new member of the Recreation Commission, Corey Pinto. And I'm looking for a motion.
Move the appointment of Corey Pinto.
Second.
Motion by Arthur, second by Bill. Any questions? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, Mr. Pinto is appointed to Recreation. We also have an email that was passed on to us by the Recreation Commission that Thomas Driscoll is forced to resign his position on the commission.
Mr. Chairman, I move to accept the resignation with regret of Tom Driscoll from the Recreation Commission, effective immediately.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Arthur. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. It's unanimous. We have an email from the Commission on Disabilities, Chairman Tom Weinrich. He is asking us to accept the resignation of Diana Julian from the Commission on Disabilities.
Mr. Chairman, I move to accept the resignation with regret of Diane Julian from the Commission of Disabilities, effective immediately.
Is there a second? Second by Arthur. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. It's unanimous. Next item on our agenda is on November 21st, 2016. This board met with Police Chief Wall on his request the town explore local control options contained in ballot question number 4, which was the legalization of recreational marijuana that was passed on November 8th. And the board voted to form a subcommittee to review those local control options and will be comprised of the police chief, the town administrator, a member of the Board of Health, and a member of the planning board, and a selectman. Since that meeting, we have filled that committee except for the position of representing the Board of Selectmen. So I would ask the board for a volunteer selectman to join this committee under the direction of Police Chief Wall and Town Administrator Ed Thorn.
Be a good job for you.
Yeah, I'll volunteer for that.
Excellent, Matthew. That's great. So
we appoint Matthew Furlong to the open position.
Second.
Thank you, Arthur. And a second by Bill. Matthew Furlong has been nominated. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. I want to thank you very much for volunteering, Matthew. And we need to get in touch with the police chief now that we have a committee, and we need to have a meeting, a first meeting of that group. So maybe between you and Ed Fawn, we can scout up a first meeting of that group.
Okay. Okay.
Good. The Planning Board is holding two public hearings on February 6th regarding two separate proposed zoning bylaw amendments for the town meeting that pertains to the Center Protection District. And they are required to put an advertisement in the newspaper about that. And knowing that that was going to be posted, when I got the local paper this weekend, I scouted through the paper to find it. And it is in the paper, and they are doing what they are required to do. However, if I hadn't been looking for it, I don't think I would have found it. I would have noticed it. And so therefore, I'm not sure how many people that live in the Center Protection District are going to even know about it. So when we have a hearing, we would like to get in and anticipate getting interested residents who may be affected by whatever change is going to be proposed. So I spoke to the town administrator about this, and he suggested that the Board of Selectmen send out a notification in addition to the ad in the paper telling the residents in that area about the hearing scheduled on the 6th of February. So Ed, would you like to maybe clarify who we're thinking of sending this out to? Is it an abutters list or?
Well, I think as you and Dan know from experience on the planning board, a lot of zoning bylaw changes sometimes don't directly affect residents of the town. They may affect industrial zones or commercial zones. In this particular case, this is affecting a zone in which it affects not only the commercial aspect of the community, but residents as well. And on the heels of ZBA decision that took place in the last 6 to 8 months about the Center Protection District and a project that was proposed in mixed-use development for residential and for commercial, it appears that the Planning Board has a philosophical difference from what is currently on the bylaws. And so they have proposed two changes to the zoning bylaw dealing with the Center Protection District, one dealing with mixed-use development itself, and the other with the boundary line of the zone of that particular project. Right now, the bylaw says that it's 300 feet deep from the road or the parcel, whichever is greater. So if you own a parcel of land that's in that district and it's 500 feet back from the road, then the district extends the entire 500 feet. And the proposal by the Planning Board for the second public hearing is to have a straight line of 300 feet, which means in some parcels you would have one zone for 300 feet and another zone for the remaining part of your parcel. So anyway, in discussing this, we felt that because there was so much interest in the development that is occurring at 220 Center Street, that is a mixed-use development, that we felt, as Lou said, that if you weren't looking for that advertisement, you probably wouldn't be, you wouldn't run across it. So we thought that it would be transparent to the folks in that area that they know that the Planning Board is holding a required public hearing on February the 6th here at Veterans Hall.
I'd just like to add to that that I've talked to the chairman of the Planning Board about this action, and he has no issue with it. He thinks it's a good idea to get as many people to a hearing as possible, and he thought that the idea was certainly acceptable to him. So I figured that he ought to know about it, so I called him.
So how will they notify these people?
You're gonna, this is a mailing?
It'll be a mailing.
Okay, because the Reverse 911 is if you called the sheriff and told him that you wanted specific streets, or specific sides of the street or whatever, he can do that. You just have to draw up something on what you want to notify and what you want to say, pass it in front of the fire chief, and he'll call down and have it done. It doesn't have to be an emergency thing. It can be a notification that the water is going to be out for 2 days, or street lights are out, or the whatever else is happening. So we can use that if that's something that you want to use. We could always use the town website and Facebook or something like that, but that definitely would reach everybody.
I think you give the public an opportunity to be heard and to be involved. I don't think that that can be any better an offer than to put it out in the mail and put it out on E911 and the website and the Mariner and WATD, and make it so that it's broadcast, you know, well and often, and you'll get people there. Because there's nothing worse than coming home to find out that your home has been rezoned and your next door neighbor now is not going to be a house any longer, it's going to be a McDonald's.
Well, I
think the board looks to Dan as to be our expert on anything that has to do with the planning. I was wondering if you had any comment you'd like to offer.
Well, when the planning board has a public hearing that affects a property, they're compelled to send out a certified mailing to all the abutters. But this case is not a specific property so much as a zone. So there must be a loophole in their procedures that they didn't have to have a mailing out to everyone within the zone. But I think this letter that's sent out, that will be sent out, that we have here in our packet, is very informative. It tells any resident that receives it exactly what's to be expected at this public hearing, and gives them information on how to research even more prior to the meeting. So I think a mailer is a great idea, and I think some of the other ideas that Bill and Arthur put out there, whether it's Facebook or the reverse 911, that'll get a lot of eyeballs on this and a lot of attention. So anyone that's interested won't be left out in the cold.
Well, I certainly agree with that. Does anybody have any other comments? And could I ask you to make a motion on that, Dan?
Make a motion to send the mailer out as presented in our packet to the affected properties within the Center Protection District, and also put notice on the town website and the town Facebook site, the same content of that letter, and contact the fire chief to further contact the Plymouth County regarding the feasibility of a reverse 911 call.
Excellent. I have a second.
Second.
Second by Bill. All those in favor to Dan's motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, I deem it unanimous. I need a vote on the minutes of January 9th this year.
Move to approve the minutes of January 9th, 2017.
Second.
Motion by Arthur, second by Bill. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, it's unanimous. Under old business, on August 9, 2016, Governor Baker signed an act to modernize municipal finance and government, and that gave the authority to one selectman to sign the warrants if it was not possible for the entire board to do so. So, a record of the actions of the board's designee, which is myself, on January 18th, 2017, I am pleased to report that on January 18th, I personally reviewed five accounts payable warrants totaling $415,920.38 and one payroll warrant totaling $211,900.97 prepared by the town accountant and authorize the itemized expenditures for payment. Signed, Louis W. Stone, Board of Selectmen's designee. The next item under old business is back on November, the board decided to prepare a survey. It was Matthew Furlong's idea, and we have completed a survey to the public about the open meeting law rules on meetings and agendas, and I'd like Matthew to take us through the results of that survey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm very happy to report that all the committees seem to fully understand the law, and they have no need for any more information of the law. And everyone seems to feel that they want to comply or are currently complying with the law. Now, as we all know, that's not really happening. So, after going over the survey, and since everyone already understands the law and has appointed someone to record the notes for the most part, I feel the best option is to record every meeting that takes place as a backup. So when a meeting does not get recorded properly, then we can go back to the recording then and rewrite the report.
I think that's a great idea.
Good.
Recorded, not with video camera, but with just the audio.
So do you feel that the survey produced the results that you were hoping to get from it? And I know we got a lot of responses.
We did get a lot of responses. I was hoping to get, I felt that it was kind of what we were expecting. Everyone wants to follow the law, understands the law. Everyone has appointed someone on their board to be a secretary or write down what happens. It just simply seems that it's not happening every time. And as we all know, we're way under the amount we should be for these reports going online.
Yeah.
So we need to do something about it.
Well, speaking for myself, but probably it's true of other members of our board, at some time during our careers in town government, we were on different boards and commissions, and sometimes in the capacity as chairman and maybe even being as a clerk. But it's a very difficult job to do it and do it right. And it does take a dedicated person to take the minutes and to get them completed and get them approved. And then as our bylaw requires, get them on the website. Now, as you know, I've been tracking the results for the calendar year 2016. And in looking at the boards and committees that have posted agendas and minutes on our website, we are, when you take a look at the number of agendas that were posted during the calendar year, and then the corresponding number of minutes posted for those meetings, we're running about 55% of the agendas that are posted have corresponding minutes describing what occurred on that particular meeting. So we're a little over 50%, I'll say 55% compliance. And as you remember, we do have a bylaw that we passed that said, in addition to what's required under the open meeting law, we're requiring that they be posted on our website. And there are a number of positive reasons why we did that. I won't go into them now. So I guess my question to the board is, now that you have my report and I could give it to you, copies of it, but verbally that's what the report says. My question is, what do we want to do about it? What else can we do to have our committees and boards comply with the bylaw that we passed to have all the minutes and agendas posted on the website.
I recommend that someone at the committee, in each one of these committees, the person who designates themselves or becomes designated as the secretary, whoever's recording them, going to create the minutes to record each session. Most people have a cell phone these days that can do so very easily, but if they do not, the board can, or the town can lend them a recorder. And then with this audio recording handy, any meeting that does not have minutes attached to it, we can go back, find the audio, and create minutes retroactively.
But do you have any comments on Matthew's suggestion of recording?
I think it's a good idea to record it. It's I don't think that it costs a lot of money to buy a small recorder and do that to each department head that's supposed to be reporting to us and supposed to be putting the minutes in. So I would even add to his motion that the town supply the recorder to each one of the boards with a letter to the chairman of that board indicating that that our purpose is to record every meeting and have the minutes available.
Anybody have any comments? Dan?
Yeah. You know how much work you just created for Sabrina? Who's going to listen to these minutes? I mean, where are we going? What are we doing with this?
Well, I believe...
Seriously, I mean, who is going to listen to every single minute meeting? And who's going to store them? Who's going to file these away? I mean, I don't have an issue with doing it. I'm just telling you, you're creating red tape that you're never, ever, ever going to use.
Well, some of us have been chairmen of committees and boards. And one of the responsibilities of a chairman is to appoint a recording secretary, or whatever term you want to use for that position. And their main responsibility is to record the minutes of the meeting and to write them up and get them approved at the next meeting. And then the open meeting law requires copies of those to go to the town clerk, but our bylaw requires, in addition, that they get posted on the website. So we even give people that we appoint to committees and boards a booklet that tells them how to run, what their duties are as a help. And so I really don't know why we're in this mess. When I was in business, I remember I was appointed recording secretary to a committee that had 25 people on it. And what a job that was. Now you say, well, you're getting paid to do that. Well, it was in addition to my regular job. Somebody liked me and said, well, let Lou do that. Well, I had to figure out how to get that done and get it done quickly and accurately. So I know how difficult it is. But if you volunteer to be on a board or a committee, you gotta know there's gonna be work involved. So if somebody asks you to be a recording secretary, that's not out of the realm of possibility. Yes, Dan.
Everything you're asking for is perfectly reasonable, and not only is it a state law, it's our bylaw. So I don't have an issue with asking or even demanding that the committees and boards do a better job, actually do the job that they're compelled to do by law. And in fact, I can even understand your frustration, and I'm frustrated too. And the only thing I brought up about the recording was that the mechanism for going through it, if we have a committee that's derelict in their duties, which some are, and we do have, even if they do press play on the recording. Now, I'm just thinking of the red tape on now we have to listen to the hour and a half meeting. We have to take notes and transcribe it, and then it has to go back in front of the board for them to approve the minutes. and they may not approve them because they didn't write them down. A third party wrote them down. You see, so it's maybe we can buy a recorder and ask people, or maybe two, and hand them out. But I wouldn't want to give one to every committee unless they ask for one. I don't know how the mechanism for doing it.
I said every department head that we're assigning to do a particular function. You know, it's every one of our meetings are recorded.
Right.
They're all on the website. You can see it on YouTube or whatever. It's an important thing that people want to know what's going on here. And as you see, the people who are sitting in here tonight at the advisory board, they're upset that they don't know what's going on in some of the meetings that we're having on executive session. So why not record it?
Yeah, and don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that recording asking them to record it's a bad idea. I'm just wondering. We're going to get frustrated down the line because the mechanism or the personnel time to listen to these.
Well, the recording secretary, from what I understand, now I know Sabrina records some of the minutes that she does because it's easier for her. It would be easier for me and take some short notes and that night go home and type it up. You know, when I do, sometimes I do a recording for some of the meetings that I attend. And it's not my favorite thing to do, but when it's my job to do it, then I do it, and right. I get it done right away. But if you record the meeting, it's some of the ones I go to the North River Commission. What they do is they when they start the meeting at 7 o'clock or whatever, they press the button and they say, "This is who's here. This is what's going on. This is what the agenda is." You can refer to item number 452 or whatever the number on the meeting is, date and time or whatever that's put on there, and then record what everybody is saying. Because at the end of the meeting, sometimes the meetings are so complex that you can't write everything down. So at least it's a better way for the secretary or the recording person to go back and listen to it and say, "Oh, I forgot all about that. So let me put that down." So they can make notes from the recording and then type up their minutes from what they've heard on the recording. So it's sometimes you might not remember everything that's in a meeting, especially if it's a long one.
I don't have any issue with recording them. And don't forget, nearly every single person has a smartphone now, so they can record it right on their phone. So they don't need the old cassette tape player anymore. So if there was someone out there that was responsible enough to write the minutes and caring enough to get it so right that they would want to record it, already has the capability most likely. So
good. Yeah, it could be so. But I mean, I've been to meetings in the past where you read the minutes of the meeting afterwards. And you say, "Geez, was that the same meeting that I attended?" You know.
Right.
So, at least with it being recorded, there is a certain amount of time, and I know it's a pain in the neck, but there's a certain amount of time you have to hold those tapes. So, whenever you do record something, that definitely has to be held for a certain amount. I don't know if it's 6 months or a year. Do you know what that is, Ed?
Only for public hearings, for say the ZBA or the planning board, they have to hold their tapes. A regular meeting, just a recording of it as an aid to the meeting.
Right.
I don't think there's any law that requires them to hold it for any length of time.
Yeah, so maybe the public ones they do. So maybe we should look into that and come up with something.
Are we creating a bigger problem than actually exists? Because if 55% of the boards are turning in their paperwork properly, does that mean we have 6 or 8 boards that aren't? And maybe the question should be, should we have the chairman talk to them or call them and say, "You're not doing the job right," because you can't fire volunteers. So we have enough trouble getting them, never mind discouraging them by saying, you know, they'll get booted off the board if they don't do the job right.
It'd be like, "Don't threaten me with a good time."
I think, you know, we may be creating a monster that we don't need to create. because there are several boards, the ZBA and planning and Board of Health, that record their meetings anyway. And,
right. You know, so those, they wouldn't even be affected by it, so, because they do it anyway, so.
Right, so we need to address the 45% who aren't doing the job right, right. And maybe, you know, a fast phone call or an email or something like that, and then we'll bring it up to 85 or 90%.
From my understanding, we already sent them a couple of letters, right?
One that I remember.
Yeah.
Well, this
well,
is a...
Why don't we... maybe we could continue this for a week and let's think about it, and maybe we can come up with some better ideas by next week, and maybe we have a little bit more facts about it.
Okay. I think Arthur's on the right track. You know, a phone call from the chairman or designee to them.
Yeah. You can be both our chairman and our designee, Lou.
Well, I think if you recall, this whole idea, I think I brought it to the board and we discussed it and back and forth, and we decided that was a good idea. Again, I won't go into all those reasons why we thought it was a good idea, but I still believe it is. And so why don't I do some further investigating on who's good and who isn't, because I didn't really want to bring that to this meeting tonight and say this board is terrible and this board is doing a great job. I don't want to get there, but I can do that myself, and then we can think about it for another week, and we'll come up with something, that either a phone call or an email, and what we're going to say, and I will do it.
And you don't have to do it officially. You just pick up the phone and call. I mean, all their email addresses are right here for the boards and committees, so you have them. And if you need a cell phone or a home phone, Sabrina can get it to you. You know, for the fistful that are egregious.
Yeah.
Maybe find out what the backstory is. I mean, sometimes there's a legitimate reason.
Yep.
Other times it's just being derelict in your duty.
Yep. All right, so let's we'll put this off for another week on the agenda, and I'll do a closer look at it, and we'll see where we go from there.
Seeing that we're talking about this, is one other thing that I would like to suggest is that the that the Board of Selectmen or designees from the Board of Selectmen meet with I'm forgetting where they are.
Conservation.
With the conservation next week to discuss minutes of meetings and stuff that were pulled from the website and held in abeyance, and town council looked at them and found that they were not appropriate, and there was a lot of inappropriate things that were in there, and I think that the board should get together with town council and meet with conservation and discuss these issues, because those issues should be taken care of and those minutes should be posted accordingly after they're corrected. So we'll leave that up to Ed to try to see if we can schedule that for next week or very soon.
Well, I've been familiar with that issue and those minutes, so I would volunteer to assist in any way that I can.
And so would I.
Okay, any other questions anybody wants to bring up before we move on to the town administrator's report? Does anyone have an issue for Ask the Selectmen? Does anyone wish to bring up any new business?
The only thing I'd like to say is there's no ice on the ponds, and I'm very happy about that.
Okay.
I think of you every time I see somebody out playing on the ice, Bill. But, Dan and I, and I believe Ed was there Friday and Saturday, or at least Friday, we attended the MMA trade event, and it was, as it is every year, you learn something new every time you go there, and we had the opportunity to hear Senators Markey and Warren speak, as well as Governor Baker, who is a very engaging guy, first of all. I had only met him once before.
Very tall.
He's about 6'8". Celtics could use him. But he gave us some good news, at least on the outset, not knowing what the figures will look like for income. But he was very positive about Chapter 70 money. And Dan, what else did he highlight?
As far as Chapter 70 money, he was guaranteeing $20 per student reimbursement to the towns. And the 3.9%?
I believe that's the figure. So he was very upbeat for, speeches that were people down in the dumps in a lot of cases. He painted a pretty optimistic view of what budget time should look like. So I'm hoping that he's true to his word.
Right, and one of the encouraging things was that he spoke of local aid and holding true and fast to keeping local aid to the towns and not stripping it or clawing back and bringing it back to the state. So it's encouraging to see a governor of any designation, Republican or Democrat, speak highly of distributing local aid and having that as a high priority for him.
I have one question, Ed. Maybe you know the answer. Weren't we allowed $25 a student?
Well, I think what Arthur and Dan are referring to is that it was the increase of by $20 a student.
Oh, increase it by 20.
That's wonderful.
Wow. Very good. Thank you.
Yeah, he was very positive and very encouraging, and as I say, in an environment that the last couple of weeks hasn't been always positive, but he was very good. And I don't think it's a Democrat or Republican issue as far as the Chapter 70 money goes. It affects all of us, and it doesn't ask you whether your child's a Democrat or a Republican.
Right. Right. Well, that was excellent. I'm glad we were so well represented.
It was a good event to go to, and you pick up some of the things along the way. And I found a vendor, through a vendor, for the seasonal speed bumps if we decide to go in that direction with contacting the DPW at some point, which I plan to do off over the next couple of weeks.
Those definitely make you slow down.
Yeah, they will.
Very good. We have some upcoming issues. January 30th at 7 p.m., we will have a public hearing right here in Veterans Hall on a new proposal for a 40B on off of Water Street called River Marsh Village. On February 6th, Kathleen McCarthy, our treasurer, will award on the bond sale, excuse me, and also on February 6th at 7 p.m., the Planning Board are holding two public hearings on a change of zoning that affects the Center Protection District. On February 13th, Jennifer Mathias will be here to give us an update on the Hill Bog project on Valley Street. And on February 13th at 7:30 p.m., there'll be a poll hearing, a joint petition, National Grid and Verizon, for a poll on Elm Street. We have a need for executive session, Mr. Thorne.
Yes, sir.
May I have a motion, please?
Move that we go into executive session to discuss the strategy with respect to collective bargaining or litigation. If an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining or litigation position of the public body and the chair so declares, that would be for clerical DPW, police, and fire unions.
And the chair does declare. A motion by Bill, second by Arthur. Dan?
Yes.
Matthew?
Yes.
Bill?
Yes.
Arthur?
Yes.
And I vote yes.
Discuss something before we went in.
Oh, sorry.
You want to hold the vote for a moment, just because we have a letter from the Attorney General's office where we were several months ago accused of violating the open meeting law. We were accused as such by a member of the Board of Health, and a three-page letter came back, and the conclusion is we find the Board of Selectmen did not violate the open meeting law. We now consider the complaint addressed by this determination to be resolved. So we were right then, and we were right now.
Excellent. Thank you, Arthur.
And I said it would cost us $20,000 before we were done, and it cost $19,080. So I missed by $900.
You're slipping.
Okay. Well, we've had a motion for executive session, and we have a voice vote. And we are not planning on returning to public session to take any votes. And I'd like to say that the next meeting of the Board of Selectmen will be Monday evening, January 30th, a week from tonight, but it will be at 6:30 p.m., not 7. Thank you very much for watching, and we'll see you next Monday at 6:30.